Today we have Captain Prarthna Khandelwal with us. She is FAA CPL and she's going to have a session with you all. So first session would be taken by the Captain Prarthna Khandelwal. So over to you, Captain Prarthna.
Thank you, Mandir. So, hello everyone. I'm Captain Pratna Khandelwal. We'll be discussing a little about basics of flying. So, I'll be sharing a presentation. Can everyone see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, let's start. So, basic of flying. First of all, let's come to the invention of aeroplanes. So, how were they invented? A lot of you must already have a basic idea that it was invented by the Wright brothers between 1904 to 1905 exactly. And Wright brothers, they developed their flying machine. They first developed a Wright of Flyer 2. After that, they developed it and made it into a fixed-wing aircraft that is known as the Wright Flyer 3. The brothers' breakthrough was the creation of the three-axis control system. So basically, they created this Wright Flyer 3 machine where they had this creation of three axes that enabled the pilot to steer the aircraft effectively and maintained its equilibrium. That is to steer the aircraft, the direction, and everything else. These are the Wright brothers. This was how their invention looked like. So we take flying for granted, but it's one of the most recognizable invention. As you can see in the presentation, that we take it for granted that we can fly from one side of the world to the other in a matter of hours. But a century ago, this amazing ability to race through the air had only just been discovered. The airplane is rightfully recognized as one of the greatest inventions of all the time because right now you can travel to any part of the world in very less amount of time. Now, how do planes fly? So if you ever watched a jet plane taking off or coming into land, the first thing you'll have noticed is the noise of the engines. So whenever you must have traveled in an airplane, you must have noticed that there's always this engine sound. You cannot notice a lot in the commercial aircrafts. But if you've ever gone in shorter training aircraft, you must have definitely noticed the engine sounds or in fact the ATRs as well. And so you might think that engines are the key to making a plane fly, but that's not the thing. The engine is not the only thing that helps in the aircrafts in flying. There's the thing called gliders. They can fly without engines. They can stay in the air because they are lighter than air. We already discussed about the gliders in yesterday's session, so I'm not going to go in detail. Now, the plane flies using the basic four forces. That's the lift, that is the upward force, the weight is the downward force, the backward force is the drag, and thrust is the forward force. So these forces, they balance out each other and they help you in going wherever you want the aircraft to go. When lift is greater than weight, the aircraft flies, it gains altitude. When weight is greater than lift, weight is basically the downward gravitational force. So when weight is greater than the lift, the aircraft descends. When thrust is greater than drag, the aircraft moves in the forward position. And when drag is greater than the thrust, the aircraft moves in the aircraft actually doesn't move in the forward position. So, yes, these forces balance out each other. When lift is equal to weight and thrust is equal to drag, that condition is known as stability. Next are some flight control services. So, we control the aircraft using some of these flight control surfaces. The first one you can see is the spoiler. The spoiler is located towards the front part of the wings. So, spoiler basically is there to reduce the lift. So why do we need to reduce the lift? The reason why we need to reduce the lift is to prevent stalls. Stalls is basically a condition in an aircraft where the aircraft climbs up to a certain angle. After that, it starts descending. At that time, it feels like a leaf. The aircraft feels like a leaf. It doesn't have any power. And it's a little difficult. You have a proper technique to like stabilize the aircraft after you enter a stall. So spoilers is basically to prevent stalls. That is by preventing the lift. Next up is the ailerons. As you can see, the blue part they have mentioned here. These ailerons, they maintain the directional control of the wings. So usually there's a stick or a yoke that controls the movement of the ailerons. If you want to go the way, if you want your wings to go towards the left, you will use the stick or the yoke to turn left, same way for right. Then we have the flap. Flap, you can see this right here, the inner part of the wing. These are the flaps. So flaps are basically a kind of setting that enables the aircraft, that puts the aircraft in such a condition that it becomes easy for the aircraft to take off or land or maintain a straight and level flight. So I'm going to tell you the basic flap settings. It's the flaps to take off. So whenever you have to take off, you put the flaps to take off. It helps with all the aerodynamical flow of the air and helps in lifting the aircraft. Then is the flaps to landing. When you keep the flaps to landing, it helps in landing. And then you have the flaps at the normal setting, that where the normal setting you do when you have a leveled flight. Then the next up is the rudder. Rudder, you can see the red part on the tail, that is the rudder. It basically controls the yaw movement. Yaw movement is the movement of the nose. So sometimes what happens because of the weather conditions, because of the winds, crosswinds and everything else, the ailerons and rudders are not always adjusted. You need to make sure that the ailerons, that is the wing movement, and the rudders, that is the nose movement, is adjusted, is in coordination to avoid uncoordinated flight, because that again is a dangerous attitude which should be avoided. So using rudders, you can control the nose movements. Then next up, we have the trim tabs, the left green color thing, that's the elevator. The trim tab is the small square, if you can see on the red rudder, that's the trim tabs. So trim tabs is basically, so sometimes a lot of turbulence and a lot of things happen. So in the training aircrafts, those are very light. All of the winds and turbulence affects the aircraft a lot. So the trim tabs are to ease the pilot's load. When you trim the aircraft, suppose you climb to an altitude and you're experiencing a lot of gusts. So when you use this trim, it makes flying easier. It relaxes a little bit of the controls for you. And it keeps the aircraft a little bit stabilized. Then next up is the elevator. The green color part, that's the elevator. Now, so the aircraft has basically three axes, the roll axis, the pitch axis, and the aircraft has three axes, longitudinal, lateral, and vertical axis. These are the three axes of rotation. Now, the ailerons, these ailerons right here, their axis of rotation is the longitudinal axis. The elevators right here, their axis of rotation is the lateral axis, and the rudders right here, this rudder part, their axis of rotation is the vertical axis. This is all the basic things that you need to know about the flight control surfaces. Next up is the elements of flying. Now airfoil. Airfoil is basically the shape of the wings mostly. Airfoil is technically defined. So here's the definition of airfoil. Airfoil is technically defined as any surface such as airplane, aileron, elevator, rudder, or wing designed to obtain reaction from the air through which it makes. So basically, shape designed for the proper aerodynamical airflow and helps in flying. So here are the labelings of the parts of the ailerons. The first one, the front one, is the leading edge. Then the end one is the trailing edge. The upper part of the airfoil structure is known as the upper chamber. The lower part is known as the lower chamber. As you can see, they've already been marked here. Then you have this line, a curvish line from the leading edge to the trailing edge. That is the front part of the wing to the last part of the wing. This is known as the mean camber. And there's a straight line from the leading edge and the trailing edge. That is the front part of the airfoil to the trailing edge. That straight line is known as cord. So this is the basic structure of airfoil, or the shape of the wing, elevator, rudder, ailerons, and everything. And these are the different parts of it. Next up is the angle of attack. So angle of attack is the acute angle that is measured between the cord of an airfoil and the relative wind. So this angle of attack, as we discussed in the previous slide, is related to the stalls. So as I said that there's a particular angle after which the aircraft descends and then floats like a leaf. That angle is known as angle of attack. Once you exceed this angle of attack, your aircraft will go into a stall. And it is a little difficult to recover from it when it comes to the commercial aircrafts. Trading aircrafts, if you use the proper techniques, you will be able to recover from it. So as you can see in the diagram, the angle of attack, it is basically an angle between the cord. Cord, as we saw in the previous diagram right here, it is the line from the leading edge to the trailing edge. So that's the cord, and the relative wind is the wind that's faced by the aircraft. So the angle between these two is known as angle of attack. Next is this Cessna 172 cockpit. So as you can see, this is like more like an old-fashioned cockpit. There are glass cockpits nowadays, which helps in better understanding and everything. So this is basically how a Cessna 172 cockpits look like. And a lot of flying clubs use this aircraft for training purposes. So there are these instruments. You look up onto these instruments and fly according to them. Basically, it's a six-dial instrument. Six-dial instrument involves your airspeed indicator, the attitude indicator, the altimeter, heading indicator, the vertical speed indicator, and the turn coordinator. Let's go and see what all these six-dial instruments look like. So this is the airspeed indicator. As you can see in the diagram, it tells you the airspeeds in knots. What is knots? Knots is nautical mile per hour. So this right here is the one part of the six-dial instrument, that is the airspeed indicator. You can see the color bands here. The white one, the green one, the yellow one, and this red line. So this white range is known as the flap operating airspeed. Then this green right here is known as the normal operating speed. So you can, an aircraft can normally operate in all these airspeeds without any problem. The yellow one right here is known as a little bit of conscious airspeed. While flying in these airspeed, you should be a little bit cautious. It's recommended to not fly at these, but if you want to, or if there's some emergency or you're forced to fly, then you should be cautious while flying in this. This red color line right here should never go to this speed. This can cause structural damage. This usually causes structural damage. Even this cautious range, when you're flying in these airspeed, this might cause some structural damage or something. Like in small aircrafts, it can result in small cracks in certain control surfaces. Control surfaces, we went through them, the elevators and everything. So if there's a crack in control surfaces, obviously the whole aerodynamic structure will be destroyed and there'll be a controllability issue. Next, the second one out of the six dial instruments is your attitude indicator. So the blue part, as you can see, is the sky, refers to the sky. The brown part refers to the land. So it tells the attitude of the aircraft. Like if you, attitude means if you're climbing or descending or turning, all of this, what is the attitude of the aircraft? So usually we say that 10 degrees is considered normal when you're climbing. So this basically tells you how steeply you're climbing or how steeply you're descending, because steeply descending is dangerous because you're directly facing towards the ground. And steeply climbing is also dangerous because once you reach your angle of attack, you might get into a stall and it might not be easy to recover from it. So it's always good to have a look at it, to have a look at the attitude of the aircraft with respect to the horizon. This line right here between the sky and the land is the nominal horizon. So yes, you should always be updated about the attitude of the aircraft. And you should always refer to this instrument while flying, because sometimes there's a false horizon. So whenever you look outside while flying, sometimes because of certain factors like night, the clouds, the visibility, you might have a confusion as to what the original horizon is. You might not be able to see it properly, or you might see the false horizon. So for that, this instrument is really helpful. The third out of the six dial instrument is the altimeter. Altimeter tells you the altitude of the aircraft. That's pretty much what the altimeter does. Next is this right here is the heading indicator. It tells the heading of the aircraft. So as you can see, this is the north, this is south, this is east, and this is west. So this tells the heading of the aircraft. If your aircraft is on the 030, this is 060 degrees, this is east is 090, this is 120, this is 150, this is south, that is 180, this is 210, this is 240, this is 270 degrees, this is 300 degrees, and this is 330 degrees, and this north is either 00 degrees or 360 degrees. So all the 360 degrees here on the heading indicator that tells you the heading of the aircraft. Though it has some errors, but it just like tells you the basic, it gives you the basic idea basically. Next is the vertical speed indicator. So this is the vertical speed indicator right here. So when you're climbing or descending, there's a particular rate that you're maintaining. For example, 1,000 feet per minute or 500 feet per minute. So it depends on how fast you want to climb or how slow you want to climb, or same way with descent, how fast you want to descend or how slow you want to descend. So it depends on that. So yes, it basically gives us the rate of climb or rate of descent. The last out of the six dial instruments is the turn coordinator. So this turn coordinator, so as I discussed in one of the previous slides, that while you're turning, your wings and the nose should be in coordination. Otherwise, that might lead to a dangerous attitude for the aircraft. That can lead you to a spin and stuff. So here, right here, you can see right now the nose of the aircraft, which is controlled by the rudders, and the wings, that is controlled by the ailerons, are coordinated. That is why this ball right here is in the center. But if they're uncoordinated, this ball, if it goes towards the left here, is when the rudders come in use. This ball, when it comes to left, you will push the left rudder to bring this ball to center. If this ball goes to the right, you'll put the right rudder to bring this ball back to the center. So this is pretty much what the turn coordinator does. You just have to maintain this ball at the center and you will be good when it comes to the turns. You will be coordinated. Here's the glass cockpit that I was talking about. This is a Diamond Aircraft DA40. It's a single engine aircraft, just like the Cessna 172 that we saw in the previous slides. So this is what the glass cockpit looks like. It makes flying a little bit easier. So what is the difference here is that instead of six dial instruments, we have everything on this screen, the left screen, that is known as the PFD. The full form is the primary flight display. So you have everything right here. This is your heading indicator. This tells you the heading and stuff. This is your attitude indicator that tells the attitude. Here's a altimeter, here's a vertical speed indicator, this is the airspeed indicator. So yes, everything you have in one screen, so it becomes a lot easier to fly. Apart from this, you also have this screen right here that is known as the MFD, multifunctional display. So right here, you have a lot other things, like you can see the oil pressure level, the fuel levels, you can know about the manifold pressure, you can know about the traffic, you can see the maps and everything on this system. So flying, this makes flying a lot easier. Next, so these are the five reasons to choose to work in aviation. First up is the customer service role. So there is a customer service role. If you have entered an airport, you have seen that there are baggage handlers, there are airline ticketing agents, there are so many people around that helps you to finally get to the aircraft. Flight attendants and everything, they check your tickets and everything, they provide you with one boarding pass. And then once you're entering the flight, they check your boarding pass and everything and they make you enter. So all of this is a customer service role. Next is a technical role. Technical role includes pilots, of course, the navigators, the mechanics, or the engineers, aerospace engineers and stuff. Also, the technical roles involve the accounting, the catering, the finances of airlines and stuff, and then the airport management, the law, the security, all of that technical roles. The dispatchers, all of that are technical roles. Travel opportunities, obviously, if you work in aviation, you'll get a huge amount of travel opportunities. So if you like to travel, this is the best thing you can do. Meeting new people. So, of course, meeting new people is always a good idea. If you're an extrovert, it obviously is a good idea. And it's like if you meet new people, you explore so many new things about everything in the world. You might not be aware of certain things which the other person might be aware of. So interacting is always a good thing to do. So meeting new people, it adds on to your personality. It's good for your professional as well as personal development. And working in aviation helps you to meet new people. The opportunity to develop your career. Annual career development plan. So obviously, the opportunity to develop your career is good in aviation. You can actually develop your career in a very good and positive environment, positive way. Company benefits, excellent benefits and well-paid jobs. So the airlines, the companies in aviation, they provide you a lot of benefits like free tickets and stuff. Not a lot, but yes, to a certain extent they do, which is a good thing. Also, aviation is one of the industry in the country that pays you well. So this is another part. Then the lifestyle benefits. There's always a positive environment in this field. You have good people around you. It's a very small world. And the standard of living is really high when you work in aviation. Now let's discuss a little about two major rules of flying. So the first one is the VFR, that is known as the visual flying rule. It's basically the type of rules that you fly while looking outside. You're supposed to look outside and fly, refer to the instruments as less as possible. So like we had Cessna 172 cockpit, if you remember, the Cessna 172 cockpit. So that cockpit, using that cockpit, you were bound to look outside because there wasn't a lot that you could refer from the instruments and look inside and fly. You were supposed to look outside and fly. So this is what VFR means, looking outside and flying. VFR is always a good thing. It should be practiced if the visibility allows because it keeps you updated about so many other things. For example, birds, then clouds, which might not be detectable in the aircraft system, especially in the training aircrafts with traffic around. So in the training aircrafts, the traffic advisory is not always accurate. So you should always keep your eyes outside and inside. So you should scan both the things. So VFR is really important. You should practice this. It also helps in understanding the attitude of the aircraft and stuff. You do not have to be dependent on the instruments only. You can obviously refer them, but you do not have to be dependent on the instruments. if you have a good knowledge of visual flying rules. So here's the definition. VFR are a set of regulations under which a pilot operates an aircraft in weather conditions generally clear enough to allow the pilot to see where the aircraft is going. So yes, of course, it depends on the weather conditions. It should be able to allow you to clearly see where the aircraft is going and everything. Because if the weather conditions are not good, it might give you false information, which is, again, not good. Specifically, the weather must be better than basic VFR weather minima. So there are certain minimas for weather, for flying VFR. That is in visual meteorological conditions as specified in the rules of the relevant aviation authority. The pilot must be able to operate the aircraft with visual reference to the ground and by visually avoiding obstructions in other aircraft. So wherever you're flying, you should be able to see the ground. And you should be able to see the visual reference to the ground. You should be able to avoid the obstructions. So if all of this you can see, as I said, there's a particular minimum set that depends on different aviation authorities of different countries. So once that is fulfilled, you're good to go for VFR flying. And yes, that was the basic information about VFR. The second major rule of flying is the instrument flying rules. So this is, as you can see by the name, instrument flying rules is basically flying using the instruments. So we fly using the instruments whenever the weather conditions don't permit us. Living in India, mostly the weather conditions, or let's say visibility, is not favorable. So we fly using instruments. So a good knowledge about how the instrument works and what are the errors. Like I told you, in the six-dial instrument, there are some errors. It's not like perfectly accurate. So you should be aware of all of that while you are referring only the instrument while flying, because then you're not looking outside and your flight safety is totally dependent on the instruments. So yes, you should be able to look at that. Let's come to the definition of instrument flying rules. So conditions in which flight by outside visual reference is not safe, mostly due to lack of visibility. IFR flight depends upon flying by reference to instruments in the flight deck. So whatever instruments you have in the flight deck, reference to that. And navigation is accomplished by reference to electronic signals. It is also a term used by pilots and controllers to indicate the type of flight plan an aircraft is flying, such as an IFR or VFR flight plan. So when you fly, there are a lot of times that you have to file a flight plan. So in that flight plan is basically where you give all the details of your routes and your destination and what altitude and stuff you'll be flying to the controller. So you have to mention in your flight plan as well whether you're going to be following the instrument flying rules or the visual flying rules, because both the rules have different routes and everything that needs to be followed. So it's not like VFR and IFR routes are same. The routes are different, the altitudes are different, the headings are different, a lot of things. Now let's discuss a little bit about the aviation certificates, basically the pilot certificates. So here are some of them. Let's talk about the student pilot, the very first one. The student pilot. So the basic requirements for a student pilot certificate is you're supposed to read, write, speak, and understand English, because English is the aviation language. So English is really important. 16 years old to solo. So if you're a student pilot and if you have to go for a solo, solo means without the instructor or anybody on board, 16 years old is the minimum age for going to solo. Medical certificate, obviously, to clear all your medicals. Class 1 medicals is really important to get any of the certificates, the aviation certificates. And you must pass written test for solo. So there's a written test for solo. You must be able to clear that. Then we have the privileges. So there are certain privileges that comes with the student pilot certificate. That is, fly with an instructor until it's solo. You have to fly with an instructor until the instructor releases you for solo. After solo, you fly solo only with the instructor. So after you're done with solo, every time you go for solo, you need the instructor's permission. to you know, release you for solo, and you cannot carry passengers with a student pilot certificate. The next up is the sport pilot. Sport pilot also, the basic requirements is that you should be able to read, write, speak, and understand English. For getting a sport pilot certificate, you should be at least 17 years old. Obviously, the medical certificate is important, but also driver's license can work in medical certificate's place. So to get a sport pilot certificate, you at least need 20 hours of flying, out of which 15 hours should be with the instructor and 5 hours should be solo. The privileges of a sport pilot certificate is that only one passenger at a time. You can carry passenger, but only one passenger at a time. Plus, they may or may not pay you. It's not compulsory that a passenger will pay you when you have the sport pilot certificate. Then you can only do VFR flying. That means you cannot do IFR flying. You can only do VFR flying, that is by looking outside and not being depending on the instruments inside. So if the weather doesn't allow you, you cannot go and fly when you have a sport pilot certificate. And also when you have the sport pilot certificate, you can only fly during the day. Next up is the recreational pilot. The recreational pilot certificate, the requirements for it is you're supposed to read, write, speak, and understand English. The minimum age for getting a recreational pilot certificate is going to be 17 years. The next up is the medical certificate. Obviously, you need to clear your medicals. And for getting a recreational pilot certificate, you should clear the written as well as the practical tests. And the minimum hours that is required to get a recreational pilot certificate is 30 hours of flight time. That includes some solo flying as well. Okay. Then the privileges and limitations are that you cannot fly more than 50 nautical miles from the home airport. From your base airport, you can only fly up to 50 nautical miles. You can fly VFR and only during the day. You can carry passenger, one passenger at a time, and same, the passenger may or may not be you. So a lot of privileges of sport pilot and recreational pilot are same. That is VFR flying only you can fly in the daytime and one passenger at a time, and they may or may not be you. It's not mandatory that they'll have to pay you. Next up is the private pilot certificate. Again, English is really important. Read, write, speak, and understand English. Minimum age to get a private pilot certificate is 17 years. You should be able to clear, you should have cleared your medical. You should have a valid medical certificate, in fact. You should have passed all the written and the practical tests. And the minimum hours should be 40 hours, out of which 20 should be with the instructor and minimum 10 should be solo. It also requires, so this private pilot, it requires instrument time as well. That is reference flying only with the reference of instruments, only with the help of instruments and not looking outside. So yes, it requires 3 hours of instrument flying as well. The private pilot certificate, you should have 3 hours of night flying and you should have 3 hours of cross country. So 3 hours instrument, 3 hours night, 3 hours cross country. Cross country is basically about the distance. So every country has their own cross-country distances. For example, India, it's 50 nautical miles. So from the base airport, more than 50 nautical miles, if you go towards another airport, that is cross-country basically. So you should have 3 hours of cross-country flying in order to get a private pilot certificate. The privileges are that you can fly with passengers, but again, the passengers may or may not pay you. But yes, you can fly with more than one passenger when you have a private pilot certificate. You can only fly a VFR, but you can fly not only during the day, but at night as well. So that's all about the privileges of a private pilot certificate. Next up is the IFR certification. So there's a separate set certification given for IFR. You need to do a proper training for getting the IFR certification, that is by reference to only the instruments. So for IFR certification, you should have a private pilot certificate. then you should be able to pass all the practical test and the written test. You should have 50 hours of cross country as a pilot in command. That is the point here, that pilot, as a pilot in command, you should have 50 hours of cross country time. Cross country, that means 50, no more than 50 nautical miles from your base airport. So that is known as cross country. So you should have 50 hours as the pilot in command. 40 hours instrument experience. Instrument time should be 40 hours, out of which 15 hours with an instructor and a long cross country flight. Then we have the privileges. So fly with the passengers in instrument condition. So when you have the IFR certification, obviously you can go for the instrument conditions. Instrument conditions can be during the day, during the night, and you can fly with the passengers on board using the instruments only. Again, passengers may or may not pay you. Depends totally on the discretion of the passenger. Next certificate is the commercial pilot certificate. For getting this certificate, you should at least be 18 years old. You should have a private pilot certificate. Obviously, you should have cleared the medical certificate. And you should have passed the written as well as the practical tests. Now, for getting this commercial pilot certificate, you should at least have 250 hours of flight time, which includes 20 hours with an instructor, 50 hours cross country as pilot in command, 10 hours of instrument training. So for getting the commercial pilot certificate, you have to do the 10 hours of instrument training separate. Then 10 hours training in a plane with retractable landing gear and a long cross country flight. So retractable landing gear is, you must have seen that whenever the commercial aircrafts take off, the landing gears, they automatically go up. That's because that's known as a retractable landing gear, where the wheels can go up and come down according to the pilot's wish. And a long cross country flight, what do you mean by a long cross country flight? So basically it's a 300 nautical mile cross country flight in which you're supposed to land on three different airports. This is what a long cross country flight means. The privileges of a commercial pilot, you can fly with passengers and you can earn. You can possibly earn when you're flying with the passengers. Now, commercial pilot, it's not. So commercial pilots are of two types. Commercial pilot can be done without the instrument flying, and it can be done with the instrument flight. Mostly people prefer doing it with the instrument flying because of the weather conditions, especially in India. It doesn't really favor a lot of visual flying, so people usually go for instrument flying. But instrument flying, in order to get a commercial pilot certificate, is not mandatory. You can get this commercial pilot certificate in the single engine as well as the multi-engine aircraft. That totally depends on you. Then next up is a certified flight instructor. That we call as, that is known as CFI. So minimum age to get a CFI is 18 years, and you should hold a commercial pilot certificate, and you should have cleared all the written tests and the practical tests, and demonstrate proficiency flying on the right seat. So right seat, you should be proficient. You should be flying from the right seat. You should know how to do it. And the work of a CFI is to teach student pilots. Then we have the certified flight instructor with the instrument rating, that is known as CFII. So the requirements are the same as the CFI, that is, you should be 18 years old and you should have a commercial pilot certificate. You should have cleared written test and practical test and demonstrate flying from the right seat, including the instrument rating. Just instrument rating adds on to it. So in certified flying instructor, instrument rating is not done, whereas in the certified flight instructor instruments, instrument rating is done. The job of a CFII is to teach students to fly with the reference or by using instruments only. Next is the airline transport pilot. So you should be at least 23 years old. Then the commercial, you should have a commercial pilot certificate and an instrument rating. So for the airline transport pilot, you should have an instrument rating and a commercial pilot certificate. Pass written and practical tests, you should have at least 1500 hours of total flying time, out of which 1000 types 1000 hours needs to be in two different types of aircraft. So 1500 total, out of which 1000 needs to be in two separate aircrafts. Then we have the privileges. So the privilege of holding an airline transport pilot certificate is to work for most commercial airlines and most parcel carriers, for example, FedEx, UPS, USPS, etc. These are all the aviation certificates. You need to learn about all of these certificates, the privileges, the requirements, and everything. Now, can someone answer this? Like, we just did it like 2 minutes back. What type of aviation certificate we need to fly the given aircraft? Can someone answer this question? All right, so we need an airline transport pilot right here. We just discussed that we need an airline transport pilot for flying in most commercial airlines and most parcel carriers. So this FedEx plane right here is a parcel carrier, and we need an airline transport certificate for this. Now we have minimum age for sole control of the aircraft. So minimum age in order to fly solo is 16 years, and no one should fly solo. No one should be permitted to fly solo if you are not 16 years of age. You can fly with an instructor, but not solo. Maximum age limitations for professional pilots. So no person, it's 65 years. Let's see what's written here. No person holding pilot's license and having attained the age of 65 years shall act as a PIC or co-pilot of an aircraft engaged in the commercial air transport operations. So you should not act as a pilot in command or the co-pilot if you are 65 years of age and if you're engaged in the commercial air transport operations. For example, if you're flying in the airliners and stuff, and if you're 65 years of age, you cannot act as a pilot in command or a co-pilot. This is the Etihad commercial plane right here. So this was it from myself for this today's session.